of the love we have. We can only take you so far, as far as we can, but you'll need something more to guide your heart as you grow.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down,
worshiping now, how great, how awesome is He, and together we sing.
Yeah.
the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now.
How great, how awesome is He.
And together we sing.
Everyone sing.
Holy is the Lord. Welcome. Let's open up it with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for just a beautiful day that we can come together in freedom, Lord, and worship you openly. And Father, we just ask that you just anoint us with your Holy Spirit today and open our ears and our hearts and receive our worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. The hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures.
Fill my life again. Give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior,
is mine. river of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Conquered the grave.
Jesus conquered the grave.
Forever they will say, how
how much you love me. Forever my heart, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. Forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours.
When the
heavens pass away and the scars they still remain, and forever they will say how much you love me.
Forever my
forever my heart, forever my life is yours. Forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours.
The nails
in your hands, the nail in your feet, they tell me how much you love me. With fire, the whole earth shakes,
all earth shakes.
I see his love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people see,
people see.
Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place in selfless faith. Faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and see. We're on our knees, on our knees.
Hosanna,
Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna. Unseen, show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom cause. As I walk from earth into eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you again, Lord, just for being in our presence. And Lord, just open our hearts now.
And Job, Lord, just let us learn your word and keep it in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Morning.
Morning.
Good to see you all here. We have a few announcements this morning. If you didn't get our bulletin, I'm sure there's some out there. First thing on there is the Save the Dates. There's some awesome dates coming up this year. The first one is there's a community outreach this Saturday by the group there that meets in McDonough, the community group. But they've invited anybody that wants to come join. You could talk to Joe about that. And the second thing is the leaders, Pastor and Leaders Conference coming up at Stone Mountain in May. In July is the Youth Conference. August is our Marriage Retreat at Callaway Gardens. Mark your calendars. And then in October is the Men's Conference at Calvary Chapel Heartland. There's some more details about that outreach. And then, of course, our daily reading. And on the back is our community group questions, as usual. One other thing, the Pregnancy Resource Center is one of the local missions we support. They are having a thing at Zaxby's on Monday night. So this Monday, tomorrow night, on the Hudson Bridge Road, Zaxby's. And it's just a fundraiser deal between 5 and 8. And it says the Zaxby's will donate 10% of the food purchase to the Pregnancy Resource Center. So if you're heading that way, it'll just help support them. Does everybody have a Bible? If you don't, Lynn's got a handful of them. He's going to bring them out. And get some hands up there. Maybe. Sam's got his hand up back there. And then, do we have... does anybody have a praise report this morning they want to share? Hold on a second. Lynn's going to grab the microphone. All right, we got a little spill here.
Was it?
Nayla, right behind you.
Taya got into SCAD University, which is the college she wanted to go to.
All right. Praise God. Awesome. Anything else? Any other praise reports? That's it. Huh? All right. All right, with that, let's. I want to introduce Pastor Steve to you this morning. He's the pastor of Calvary Chapel Heartland. Most of you know him already, and he's come to give us a lesson today and take part in our exciting board meeting this afternoon.
Exciting board meeting. It's always exciting every time we get to come up here. It's a blessing to be with you all here at Calvary Chapel McDonough. Is it McDonough or McDonough? Correct me. Tomato, tomato, potato, potato. McDonough. Okay. Donna. Okay, good. I'm from California. I had to learn how to talk also when I came here. And so, yeah. Good. I'm amongst friends then. That's awesome. What a blessing it is to be here, though. And your pastor, he is one incredible, ingenious kind of guy. He shows me around all, what a blessing he is. Good. He showed me these carts that he's designed, and he doesn't want any of the glory. God gets all the glory, but it just blows my mind every time I see. Look at this pulpit. I feel like I'm at Delta or something right now. This looks like a wing or an aileron or something. But yeah, and the stage that he's designed. You guys are going to be blessed as you move over into the next room here in the Lord's timing. So exciting. But anyways, I'm happy to be here, and I see some familiar faces and some new faces. And so, why don't you go ahead and open your Bibles this morning to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 18. Matthew, chapter 18. You know, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for instruction, for correction, to help us become thoroughly equipped for every good work. And so today we're going to just go verse by verse through this entire chapter, the Gospel of Matthew chapter 18, which happens to be where we're at back home down at Calvary Chapel Heartland. And so I'm just going to feed you what I feed my sheep back home. Purina. Sheep chow. Here it is. And so let's first read through the entire chapter. And as I read it out loud, follow along your Bible and let's stand and give honor to God and his word. Let's all stand as we read the word together. I'll read it out loud and then afterwards I'll pray and then we'll go through it slower down verse by verse. It begins, "At that time the disciples came to Jesus saying, 'Who then is greatest in the kingdom of heaven?' Then Jesus called a little child to him, set him in the midst of them, and said, 'Assuredly, I say to you, unless you are converted and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles himself as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever receives one little child like this in my name receives me. But whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were drowned in the depth of the sea. Woe to the world because of offenses, for offenses must come. But woe to that man by whom the offenses comes. If your hand or foot causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you. It is better for you to enter into life lamed or maimed rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into the everlasting fire. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. It is better for you to enter into life with one eye rather than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire. Take heed that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I say to you that in heaven their angels always have the face of my Father who is in heaven. For the Son of Man has come to save that which was lost. What do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them goes astray, does he not leave the 99 and go to the mountains to seek the one that is straying? And if he should find it, assuredly I say to you, he rejoices more over that sheep than over the 99 that did not go astray. Even so, it is not the will of your Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. Moreover, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. But if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church. But if he refuses even to hear the church, let him be to you like a heathen and a tax collector. Assuredly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of them.' And then Peter came to him and said, 'Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times?' Jesus said to him, 'I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, 'Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all.' Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him the debt. But that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, and laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, 'Pay me what you owe.' So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you all.' And he would not, but he threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what had been done, they were very grieved and came and told their master all that had been done. Then his master, after he had called him, said to him, 'You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you not also have have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you? And his master was angry and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. So my heavenly Father will also do to you, to each of you, from his heart, if from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. Father God, we praise your holy name and ask that you would speak to each one of our hearts today and grow us more and more into the image of Jesus, our Lord, our Savior. Will you bless this time in your word? In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You be seated. Lots of scriptures, 35 verses. So we'll be here about 4 o'clock and then you'll be dismissed for dinner. Now I'll try to get done before then. Way before then. So, but anyways, in verse 1, Jesus says, it says here, right here, it says, at that time, the disciples, they came to Jesus saying, who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? You know, this is something like Muhammad Ali would probably want to ask. He thought he was the greatest. I'm the greatest. No. Here you see the disciples, they want to know who's going to be the greatest when they get up to heaven. You know, which one of them is going to have the highest status in heaven? And so we see that over the last 2,000 years, ladies and gentlemen, people haven't really changed. People want status. People want recognition. People way back then, just like today, they had a problem with carnality. People wanted to be exalted over one another. People wanted to be lifted up. People wanted to have power, wanted to have fame, wanted to have glory. And it seems that this was something that the disciples were always interested in. They were always arguing over that. I'm going to be this. No, I'm going to be the greatest. You know, which one of them was going to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? In one instance, we have even one of the mothers of two of the disciples, the mother of James and John, the wife of Zebedee. She gets in on the action. She gets all caught up in who's going to be the greatest in heaven. And she tells Jesus when he comes into his kingdom here that she would like for one of her sons to sit on the right hand and the other on the left hand when he came into his kingdom. And so they're all vying for position, seeking power, seeking fame. And so they asked him, who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And they probably thought, well, of course, she's going to say Peter. He was the favorite, of course. Peter, maybe James and John right after him. You know, they're the top three dogs around here. But he didn't. Instead of saying something like that, instead of saying, oh, Peter, of course, no. Look at verse 2. He says, then Jesus called a little child to him. Little kid, little child, come up to him. And he set him in the midst of them. And he said, assuredly, I say to you, unless you are converted and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. It's like Jesus, like he's saying to them, hey, you guys are so worried about who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. But in reality, if you aren't converted, become as this little child right here, this little child who I called to him and he just came to me, you know, unless you become like this little child, you won't become you won't even go to heaven. You won't go to the kingdom of heaven. The word converted there, strepho in the original, it speaks of having a change of course of one's mind, of turning around. And in this instance, it's of turning back around from their adulthood and becoming like a child, childlike. But of course, children, they trust people. They have a childlike faith. And so unless you turn from being carnal, being so concerned about who's going to be the greatest, and convert over to living life in the Spirit, that is being born again and begin to simply trust in me, just as this little child does, if you don't convert, you won't be going to heaven. You know, these guys, the disciples, they're in the flesh right here. They're being carnal. They're being prideful, wanting to be the greatest. But the Bible tells us that God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. And so in verse 4, Jesus says, therefore, whoever humbles himself as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. You see, folks, the heart attitude of people who make it into the kingdom of heaven is just the opposite of the heart attitude of the people here down on earth, here in the world. In this world, you're thought to have made it to the top, that you've really made it big if you have people, what, serving below you, that you've promoted up above everybody else, and you've got all these little people down below you serving you and waiting on you hand and foot. In this world, it's the person who's being served that's highly exalted, while the person who's the servant is thought to be the lowly peon people down below. But in heaven, folks, it's the other way around. It's just the opposite. It's the servant of all who's the greatest in heaven. You see, what's highly valued in the kingdom of heaven is humbleness and humility and service. While in this world in which we live today, it's all about pride and arrogance and having people serve us. And so really, the way up to greatness in the kingdom of heaven is the way down in the way of service, becoming the servant of all. And Jesus, our Lord, he modeled this greatness to us as he did what? As he girded himself. He took a towel and he wrapped it around himself. And he got down on his knees and he began to wash the stinky fishermen and the stinky tax collectors. He began to wash the disciples' feet. And then the next day he stooped even lower than that and he allowed sinful man to crucify him upon the cross. So clearly we know that it's Jesus. It is Jesus Christ who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. He is the greatest servant of all. They want to know who's going to be the greatest? Jesus, of course. And he says in verse 5, whoever receives one little child like this in my name receives me. And so one of the greatest things you and I, one of the greatest things we as people can do here in this life, on this planet, is to take the time to what? To love a child. To take the time to share Jesus with a child. You know, for many people, they don't have time for children. They're too busy. And in their mind, they have more important things to do than to spend time with a child, to love a child. But Jesus said, whoever receives a little child like this in my name receives me. You know what? Serving in the children's ministry over here is the biggest blessing that a person can do. It's one of the highest callings in life, loving the little children. For we see here that Jesus himself placed high priority, great priority on kids. And he was greatly interested and concerned in children's well-being. He didn't want anyone to harm his little ones. So he says in verse 6, check this out. Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, whoever causes one of these little ones to sin, it would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were drowned in the depth of the sea. You see, one of the things that really got Jesus upset was the thought of somebody harming a little child. Somebody who would seek to cause a child to sin. Somebody who would seek to destroy a child's faith. These things got Jesus upset. He says it would be better for that person if they had this heavy stone, a millstone, a stone that was used to grind up the grain. It would be better for them to have a stone like that tied around their neck than thrown overboard into the depth of the sea that would cause them to drown than to cause a little child to sin. You see, the person who's out there that would be doing anything to harm one of God's kids, one of God's little children, is going to have to go before God someday and face the fierce judgment and wrath of God Almighty. And folks, just as God, as he has various degrees of rewards for those who go to heaven, so too, he has various degrees of wrath for those who go to hell. And so the person who's harmed children is going to experience a greater judgment, a greater wrath of God. This is why our Lord, this is why he says it'd be better for that person who was going to harm some children. He says it had been better for them if they were drowned before they even did anything bad to somebody. Better that their life was cut short before they did any harm to a little child. And then he says in verse 7, woe to the world because of offenses. For offenses must come. But woe to that man by whom the offense comes. You know what, ladies and gentlemen, we live in a wicked world. We live in a perverse world. It's a perverse generation among whom we have to live amongst right now. The things that happen in this world are just disgusting to God, disgusting to the Lord. People hurting children, molestations, rapes, kidnappings, the things that are happening in the world today. And Jesus says, woe to the world because of offenses. You know, he feels for us down here. But then he says, for offenses must come. You know, it is inevitable to have this kind of crummy stuff happening in this world because we live in a sinful, fallen world. But then our Lord, he narrows it down. He says, but woe to that man, to that person by whom offense comes. You know, woe to that person who gives in and commits such evil. You know, there's going to be a hot place in hell for them waiting. You know, it just breaks my heart when I read and hear these stories of these children who have been sexually molested, of people taken advantage of and harming little children, vulnerable little kids. I really truly believe that our court system is far too lenient to these people who commit such heinous crimes against kids, leaving these children just emotionally scarred for the rest of their life. It's tragic. You know, personally, I believe that for the safety of the children, we need some much tougher laws in our country against these criminals, including life in prison for anybody who would do such wicked harm to a child. You see, there's time, folks. There is a time to take drastic measures to prevent wickedness. Look at verse 8. Jesus says, if your hand or foot causes you to sin, what's he say to do to it? Cut it off. Lop it off and cast it from you. It is better for you to enter into life lame or maimed rather than having two hands or two feet and to wind up being cast into everlasting fire. No, that's pretty drastic. He says, and if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. It is better for you to enter into life with one eye rather than having two eyes to be cast into hellfire. You know what? In this world, it is so easy to get caught up in the temporal, in the carnal things of this crummy world. It's so easy to just get caught up in the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desire for things that this world has to offer. And we forget what? The things that are more important. We forget the things of for eternal purposes. But it is infinitely more important that you and I, that we live our life in a way that will be beneficial for eternity rather than just live for the temporary pleasures of this world. Things that would cause us to sin. For this world and the things of this world are what? They're passing away. You know what? That includes you and I. That includes us. The Bible says that this life that we are living here on earth is but a vapor. It's here one day, it's gone the next. And before you and I, before we know it, each one of us is going to cross that river. We're going to cross on over into the other side of eternity. And once we get there, it'll be time no more. We'll cross from this life, which is finite. It has an ending point. And we're going to go on over. We're going to cross over into this whole new life, which is infinite. We'll enter into a whole different space-time continuum that will go on forever. And so the things that you and I, that we do here, that we do now in this life, the things that we do either in the flesh, the things that are carnal, or the things in the spirit, they are going to have a direct effect on our ability to what? To enjoy eternity on the other side. In essence, what Jesus is saying here, this is such an important issue that's going to affect all your eternity. So if you're doing something that's sinful and you know it, he says, then take drastic measures to stop, to put it out of your life so that you won't wind up in hell and torment. He says, turn from it, repent, do whatever it takes. Now, when he says, if your right hand causes you to sin or your foot causes you to sin, to cut it off. Is he speaking of this literally? To chop it off. Whoop. Foot takes you to sin, chop it off. He's not saying literally because, you know what? If I chop off my right hand, what am I going to be? I'm going to be a left-handed sinner. Chop off my right foot, okay, now I'm a one-legged sinner. Pull out my right eye, and now I'm a left-eyed sinner. He's not saying to do this literally. What he's saying is when you realize that something is leading you to sin, then do something about it. even if it means taking drastic measures, but seek to eliminate the source of that temptation from your life. How many of you saw Fireproof? Yeah, a lot of you have seen Fireproof. You think of Kirk Cameron, who plays the fire captain in that movie. He's got a problem with pornography. You know, and so he takes his computer, he takes the whole thing out by his trash can, the side of his house, he takes a baseball bat, starts smashing it, breaking it, because it's leading him to sin. Just getting it out of his life. When he smashed it, the neighbors watering the grass watching him. That's what he's saying here. Take drastic measures, drastic steps. Kurt Cameron in that movie gives an excellent example of that. And so we should do likewise. No matter what the sin, take drastic measures to eliminate the temptation. You know, if your temptation is gluttony, don't go past the table out there. Stay away from Krispy Kreme if that's your temptation. If it's drunkenness, you know, don't go hang out at the bar, obviously. If porn is a temptation, get rid of the internet. Well, we have to have the internet. Well, then take drastic measures and put some safeties on it. Do whatever it takes. Take drastic measures. You see, ultimately, your spiritual health, my spiritual health, is infinitely more important than the sinful pleasures you might gain from some stupid sin of this world when you look at it with eternity in mind. Jesus says to the disciples in verse 10, he says, take heed that you do not despise one of these little ones. Again, speaking of this little child that's standing there in his midst. For I say to you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. And so don't look down on kids and children as being nothing. You know, a lot of people, children will be seen and not heard. No. Children are worthy of your time. Jesus says, because I think so much of them that they even have guardian angels, ministering spirits, God's messengers watching over them. And these angels, they see the face of the Father in heaven. Then he says in verse 11, for the Son of Man has come to save that which was lost. I was once lost. You know, we all were once lost. People say, I found God. No, you didn't. He was never lost. Wasn't lost. We were the lost ones. He found us. If you've been born again, you were once lost. And he came to find you and he found you. And then Jesus asked the disciples a question. Look at verse 12. What do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them goes astray, does he not leave the 99 and go to the mountains to seek the one that is straying? And if he should find it, assuredly I say to you, he rejoices more over that sheep than over the 99 that did not go astray. And so right here, folks, we see the heart of the good shepherd. Of course, Jesus is the good shepherd. As a shepherd, he counts the sheep, and if he finds just one little lamb missing out of the 100 that he has, he doesn't say, oh, well, one's gone, no biggie, I got 99 others. No. He goes out and he searches high and low, even up to the rocky crags in the mountains, to find that one that is missing. He searches. He goes out of his way to find that one who's lost, who's missing. And he rejoices when he finds it, even more so than he does for the other 99 that are safely tucked away back in the sheepfold. Who cares? You know, down at Heartland, sometimes we have people that leave the fellowship and they go get plugged into another fold, another flock, another church, and great, praise the Lord. God bless you as you go. You're plugged in, no problem. What bothers me as a shepherd is when one of the lambs goes wayward and walks away, doesn't get plugged in anywhere. You try to bring them back to the fold and ooh, they're running wild. They don't want anything to do with it. It breaks my heart. It breaks the Lord's heart too. But you try to go after them. And then Jesus says in verse 14, even so it is not the will of your Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones, one of these little children, one of these lambs should perish. And so again, the importance of children to the Lord, why even again the angels are watching over them, and so should we see to it that the children are loved and cared for and provided for and brought to Jesus. Then in verse 15 he says, moreover, check this out, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him, who? Alone. And if he hears you, you've gained your brother. And so what our Lord is doing right here, folks, is he is establishing right here the form of church discipline. This is the form of discipline that the church was to use. You know, even before the church existed, Jesus was giving this. And you say, well, how do you know this is supposed to be? He tells us in just a few more verses here, a little further down. He's establishing the way that the church was to carry out discipline. Discipline simply means to train people. It's training. Well, oftentimes people think discipline is punishment. It's not punishment. It's to train people in the way that they should go. He says, if your brother sins against you, you know, if somebody does something or said something against you, then according to Jesus, you as the offendee are to go to that person who offended you, and you're supposed to go alone. You're to go to them one-on-one and talk to that person about the situation, about what they did to sin against you, how they offended you. And if that person hears you and says something like, oh, man, you know what? I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to offend you. I was wrong. Please forgive me. You know, if they say something like that, it's over. You know, you hear that and you respond with something like, then, you know what? I forgive you. And your relationship's been restored, and you've gained your brother back. But again, notice Jesus says here, they're to go alone and speak to the offending person. He doesn't say, first go and post it on Facebook. You hear that? He doesn't say, first go and post it to Facebook. Or speak to everybody else in the church. No. He didn't even say, go and tell the pastor. No. He just simply says, you go and talk to that person one-on-one. Just explain it to them, you know, how they offended you, how they sinned against you. And if that person hears it, great, it's settled. It's done right then and there. It's a done deal. All the dirty details don't need to go any further. It's over. It's forgiven. You let it go. It's over. But if the person won't hear you, then Jesus says in verse 16, but if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. And if he refuses to hear them, that's when you tell it to the church. You know, if the person refuses to hear, even though you got two or three witnesses gathered together over this situation, that's when you take it to the church's leadership. You get the pastors involved at that point. Verse 17 goes on to say, but if he refuses even to hear the church, won't even listen to the pastor. He says, let that person who offended you, let him be to you like a heathen, like a non-believer, and a tax collector. And so if this person who claims to be a believer, a brother, claims to have a faith, and they've done some sort of sin, and they refuse to listen, and it comes down to the church leadership finally getting involved, if that person refuses to repent, they remain in that sin, then they're to be treated like a heathen and a tax collector. You know, in other words, you don't have to have anything to do with them other than witness Christ to them. You know, because they're living like a non-believer. They're not repenting. But the goal was to help that person see the error of their ways and bring them to the knowledge of their sin and restore their relationship with them, you know, with the people they offended. And so, you think about that. Treat them like a heathen, a tax collector. No, not too many people want to hang out with IRS agents. They don't. And the heathen, you and I as believers in Christ, what we do with the non-believers out in the world is we witness to them. We don't fellowship with them. We can't fellowship. There's no fellowship between light and darkness. We don't mix. But we're there to be in their life and shine the light. So that's what we need to do with these people. Just shine the light to them and walk out of their life. Let them just see the love of Christ and yet not have any fellowship with them. Not until it's been restored. And again, this is what the training is for. This is what the discipline is for, to seek about restoration. But some people out there, they refuse because of their pride to receive the training, to receive the discipline. And for those who refuse, you just treat them like they're non-believers. Jesus says in verse 18, assuredly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. God, he has given you and I, we as believers in Jesus Christ, great power over the powers of darkness. And as God's children, we have been given the authority in the spiritual realm to bind evil spirits here on earth. And as saints, we've been given the ability to loose the powers of heaven by calling upon God's Spirit here on earth. And it's by praying that we have this ability to bind the powers of darkness and loose the powers of God. And so this is all being said in the context of church discipline. And the person who refuses to hear and respond to the discipline that they're being given, Jesus says, then treat them like a heathen, you know, like they're spiritually lost people who are perishing under the powers of darkness. So this is why it's important that we pray for the lost. Pray that God would bind the powers of darkness that's preventing them from coming back to fellowship. So they would repent, so they would see the truth and hear the truth, and pray that God's Spirit would then be loosed upon their hearts to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and repent. He says in verse 19, Jesus says, again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of them. How many of us here are believers in Jesus Christ? Wow, that's a lot more than two or three. He's here. Here right now by his Spirit. He's in our midst. You know, as we're gathered in this place in the name of Jesus Christ, I can say that based on the truth of God's word, that by his Spirit, he is right here in this room. The power of his Spirit is present in this place, and he can minister effectively to any one of us who are here. All we have to do now is just call upon him, which we have already done, two or more. We had a prayer meeting over here. There was two or more in that room. He's going to hear. He's going to respond. He's going to respond when? In his timing. And that's the hard part, isn't it? We want our perceived needs met when? Instantly, microwaved, you know? If not now, sooner. And yet most often in my life, God, he's met my needs, but it doesn't happen as soon as I close my prayer and amen. Sometimes the answer to the prayer for the perceived need isn't met for a long time. You know, weeks, months, years perhaps sometimes. But it is answered eventually. The answer gets through. I think of people that I've prayed for, people who were single, lonely in their singleness and crying out to God for a spouse. And, Pastor, will you pray for me? I'm so lonely. Okay, I'll pray for you. And two or more of us come together. Just pray for this brother. Pray for this sister. We pray for them. And God in his timing put something together with another person, another believer in their life, but sometimes it takes years to answer. We've seen this happen time and time again. Another time is with people that are married, they want children, they haven't been able to conceive, and they're crying, and time goes on, and God answers those prayers, and ding, there's the kids. Well, now as we come to verse 21, Peter, good old Peter. Peter, he was the apostle with a foot-shaped mouth. He's the guy that always opened his mouth and inserted foot. He knew just the right time to say just the wrong thing. And here he comes. He's going to ask a question. Now, remember, they've been talking about restoring relationships after someone sinned against you. And so we're told here, then Peter came to Jesus and said to him, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times, Lord. You know, Peter might have been feeling pretty smug about himself, thinking, isn't that pretty gracious of me? Be willing to forgive somebody seven times who sinned against me? You know, seven, number of completion. That sounds like a good number, Lord. But Jesus answered and said to Peter, verse 22, I do not say to you up to seven times, Peter, but up to 70 times seven. And when Peter heard that, his jaw fell off. Huh? 70 times 7? That's like 490 times. Lord, how can I do that? I mean, I'll lose count in trying to get a count. That's 323. Is that 319? Oh, start all over. Peter's probably thinking, man, there's no way that I could be that gracious and kind and forgiving after somebody sinned against me some 490 times. And so Jesus here is going to share a parable to help explain why it's so important that you and I, that we as believers, forgive each other. Look at verse 23. He says, therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. And so in this parable here that Jesus is teaching here, this king in this parable wanted to close out his accounts. He wanted to settle all of the debts that people owed him. You know, and one guy, he owed the king 10,000 talents. Now, folks, 10,000 talents was a tremendous amount of money. It would be like something like you and I, if we owed somebody, oh, say, roughly $60 million. That's being in debt. $60 million. I mean, it would be virtually impossible for me to come up with $60 million to pay back a king that I owed. And yet the king wants his books settled. And being that he's the king, he can demand that payment at any moment, anytime, pay up or else. So here's this poor guy. He owes the king the equivalent of $60 million, and there's no way that he can pay it. So verse 25 says, but as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold with his wife and his children and all that he had, that payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Yeah, right. How are you going to pay him $60 million? There's no way this guy's going to come up. He's begging right here. You know, that's more than he can make in his lifetime, obviously. You know, unless he was a baseball player. That's just a couple seasons. But still, he's down on the ground. He's groveling. He's begging for the master to be patient with him, not to sell his family into slavery. He says, I'll pay it back. I'll pay it. But look what this king does in verse 27. Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion. And he released him. And he forgave him the debt. Now, folks, before we go any further, you got to realize who this master is representing. The master's representing God, the Lord. Who's the one who owes the big debt? That's all us. We're the one who owes 60 grand or 60 million. What an incredible master. He forgave him the debt. Here he was owed this huge sum of money by this man, and the master let him go free. Just forgave him $60 million. I mean, $60 million is quite a bit to forgive, don't you think? And yet the master, he did just that very thing for this guy. He could have sold his man. He could have sold his entire family into slavery. But instead, he let him go scot-free, debt-free, without paying a single shekel. So this man was forgiven his debt. His master had been amazingly gracious towards him. Jesus says in verse 28, but that servant, the one who'd just been forgiven that big debt, he went out and he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. You know how much 100 denarii is equivalent today? About 50 bucks. 50 bucks. You know, this guy owes just like 50 measly dollars. And he goes out to him and he laid his hands on him, took him by the throat, saying, pay me what you owe. And so his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him. Sounds kind of familiar, doesn't it? Saying, have patience with me and I will pay you all. Well, that's feasible, 50 bucks. I mean, I could scrounge up 50 bucks myself to pay off somebody. And yet this guy, he says he would not, but instead went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. So here's this guy. He's just forgiven $60 million. You know, a debt that he couldn't pay, yet his master was compassionate towards him and released him completely from his obligation, forgave the debt 100%. But now he's not willing to forgive somebody who owed him 50 measly dollars. And he's got the guy thrown into debtor's prison over it. Verse 31 says, and so when his fellow servants saw what he had done, they were very grieved and came and told their master all that had been done. Then his master, after he had called him, said to him, you wicked little servant, I forgave you all that $60 million. I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you not also have compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you? Well, yeah, duh, come on. That's not hard to figure out. Of course he should have. So verse 34 tells us, and his master was angry. God was angry. He was ticked off at this guy because he didn't forgive the debt that somebody had against him. So he was angry, and he delivered him to the torturers. That's not pleasant. Until he should pay all that was due to him. And remember, he can't pay it. We're talking eternity in torture, in torment. And then Jesus says in verse 35, so my heavenly Father also will do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. And so, folks, this is how it is with each one of us. God, he's forgiven you. He's forgiven me. He's forgiven us this debt that there is no way possible that we could have paid ourselves. Our sins were beyond our ability to pay for. It took sinless blood to pay for our sins. It was God who took our sins through his only begotten Son, his dying for us, and paid our debt with his own precious blood. And so now that we have been freely forgiven, freely received this forgiveness of our sins, of our debt that we couldn't pay for ourselves, we now, therefore, are to freely forgive those who trespass against us. We are to be gracious. We are to be forgiving. We are to be full of compassion for people, no matter how many times people mess up, no matter how many times they sin against us. Because you see, ladies and gentlemen, the bottom line is this. We're all messed up. I'm in a room here that is full of messed up people. Have you figured that out yet, that we're all messed up? I know that we are. I know that I am because I look in the mirror every morning. I know, man, Steve, you're messed up. Yet God forgave me my debt of my sin, and he's forgiven you as well. Therefore, we must forgive others just as we have been forgiven. Otherwise, you know what's going to happen? Instead of walking around here like sheep, sheep are cute. Sheep are soft little woolly things. You know, we won't be walking around looking like sheep. You know what we'll be walking around looking like? Dobermans. If we don't forgive, we become like Dobermans, Doberman pinchers. Ever seen a Doberman snarl? Their little lip curls up and they show those fangs. Those dogs are vicious. And that's what happens when you don't forgive others. You become bitter. You become angry. You become like a Doberman. And you know what? How would you like a room full of Dobermans in here instead of a room full of sheep? I feel sorry for the first-time visitors. They come walking in the door. Who's going to Cabbage Chop McDonough? And look, all snarling. Where's the sheep? What happens? We become mean-spirited people, all because of harboring unforgiveness in our hearts. And this kind of bitterness, it just eats us up. It consumes a person's life, and it leaves them miserable. And so if you right here today, if you're carrying grudges, unforgiven sin that you haven't let somebody go of, if you're upset over things that took place, say, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago, I know people who are struggling with forgiving somebody for things that happened in the 60s. 50 plus years ago. If that's you, man, it's time to forgive. It's time to let it go. Let it go. Let it go. That'd be a good song. Forgive the person who wronged you. Set them free, and you too be set free from the torment. Just forgive them and let it go. Let them off the hook and begin to enjoy life. Again, Jesus said that, I have come that you might have life from that more abundantly. No more Dobermans. Some sheep have teeth too, but you know what? They're not for snarling and biting. They're just for grazing. You say, but Pastor Steve, I can't just let it go like that. You know, you don't know what they did to me. You know what? You're right. I don't know what they did to you. But God does. And he says, let it go. He says, just commit it to him and be free. Because if you don't, you're going to be miserable for the rest of your life. Life is but a vapor. We've already talked about it. But the choice is yours. You want to be a Doberman? You're going to be a lamb. Choice is yours. Jesus says, so my heavenly Father also will do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. May I encourage you, be quick to forgive others of the sins that they commit against you. Because your sin, $60 million worth of sin, has been forgiven you. Let's close in prayer. Father God, we praise you. We thank you so much for this time. I pray for anybody right now who is struggling with unforgiveness in their heart, that you by your Spirit, Lord, would set them free from that. That they would begin to realize just how much you've forgiven them. Amount of sin that's we couldn't pay for it ourselves. Oh, Lord, help them to forgive others of their little $50 sins against us. Set us free to experience life in you, life in Christ more abundantly. That this church here would continue to be a church that's filled with your love, filled with your Spirit, full of people who are just simply in love with you. We bless you. More love, more power, more glory for your name. In Jesus' name I pray.
Thank you, Pastor Steve. Good job. Good word there. Awesome. Anybody have a prayer request this morning? Anything that we can pray for, pray about? We have one over here. So we would gather around Jill over there. Anybody else? Attorney? All right, well, we're just going to spend just a few minutes in prayer, and then the worship team's going to come up. Lord, we just, although only one hand was raised, we all have needs. We all have things going on in our lives, Lord. And so, Lord, as we bring those up to you right now, Father, we just ask that you hear. You promised to hear as we bring these needs to you. So, Lord, as we just take a minute or two to bring our needs, our things that are going on in our lives and those that are around us, our coworkers, friends and family members, Lord, just hear us now.
I see the King of glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people see, people see. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and seek. We're on our knees, we're on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna.
Father, we just ask right now, Lord, that you bless our week and just keep our eyes on you in Jesus' name. Amen. Everybody have a wonderful week.